with you, great spirit.
Welcome to worship at Hollywood United Methodist Church. We are glad that you have joined us today as we begin our Crossflix sermon series. Whether you're in person or online, we welcome you. Please stand as you're able for our opening hymns.
Thank you. I want to invite all the children and any youth that want to come up to the steps before we head out to Children's Church to come on up. Great. Look at you. How's it going, boys? Good to see you both. Hi, Tiernan. We're happy to be together. Oh, good. Everybody's here. So who can tell me what we are celebrating this week? Let's see if there's any little ones. Okay, what are we celebrating this week?
July 4th.
July 4th. And what are we celebrating on July 4th? What is July 4th? What is it meant to celebrate?
Independence Day.
Independence Day. Wow, you have a really deep voice now. You've gotten so grown up. Yes, Independence Day. And so Independence Day is celebrating what? Okay, what else? What else would we explain what we're celebrating on Independence Day, Tierney?
America.
America. Yeah, it is like the birthday of America. It is when our country really began and was born. And so how do you celebrate? I'm going to see if I can get these folks involved. How do you celebrate your birthday? What do you do to celebrate your birthday? What do you do to celebrate your birthday? Olivia, what do you do to celebrate your birthday?
I make rainbow cards.
You made rainbow cards. That's cool.
I also got a bouncy house.
And you also got a bouncy house. Okay, good. So how do we celebrate America's birthday?
With, like, fireworks.
That's right. It's like fireworks. It's like our candles for America.
Illegal fireworks.
Well, illegal fireworks. So it all depends on, did you say legal or illegal?
Illegal.
Oh, illegal?
Unless you get a permit.
I didn't know you could get a permit for illegal fireworks, so that's cool. So I was just in Oregon last week, and actually they're a lot more legal there than they were here, so we got to light off some big fireworks. It was really fun.
Is this going to be like a special event in the church? Like fireworks? Like,
I don't know, Reverend Kathy, can we light fireworks in the church? No, sorry. It is big enough.
It really is. I mean, we might set a few things on fire.
Okay, well, we could go on for a long time. So in church, we also celebrate freedom. We talk about our freedom in Christ. And what that is talking about is that we don't have to work for God's love. We don't have to do anything to be part of God's family, to accept Jesus' forgiveness and love. That it's given to us freely, and that is the freedom in Christ. That there's nothing that we can do that will separate us from God's love, and that we are free to be here, we're free to worship, we're free to take communion, we're free to be in communion with God and with each other. And so that is what we're celebrating as we celebrate the freedom that we get in this country, the freedom that we have in Christ. So let's pray, and then we'll head off to Children's Church. Creator God, thank you for this place. Thank you for our country. Thank you for the freedom that we experience as citizens, but also, more importantly, for the freedom that we experience in you, Jesus, that you brought when you came, that you took away any barriers between us and God's love. And I pray that every day we will live that, we will recognize that, we will worship that, and we will pass that on to our children. Thank you for each of them here and the ones at home, and we ask your blessing on them and your guidance. In your name we pray. Amen. Woo. All right, well, as we head off to Children's Church, I invite you all to stand and pass the peace of Christ with one another. Talkative group. Talkative. It's good to see you. Max, right?
Peace of the Lord be with you. Let's give some peace to the balcony. We're so glad that you're here and to those worshiping at home as well. We invite you now to take a deep breath and center yourself and prepare for this powerful time in worship where we come together in prayer. And we're so grateful to be invited into that space by our wonderful choir. Creator, Mother God, Parent, Sister, Child of the Holy, may the breath of the Holy Spirit pass over us. We give you thanks this morning for this time together, for this congregation, and for the spirit of the divine feminine that fills each of us in some way. We are thankful and we give thanks for the power of sisterhood, for the communities that we make to sustain and keep us, and for the world that we're building together. We pray this morning for change. As we prepare to receive our sermon, we recognize that not all stories have been centered, and we pray to create a space where we learn about cultures and other communities and center stories of power that are not our own, where we learn about the love that others have for each other and we celebrate. God, we recognize that we live in a time when the rate of violence against Black women is very high. We pray for it to end. We remember Breonna Taylor and so many others who have lost their lives to state violence. And we call for the end of systemic racism in our government, our community, our policing, and in our church. We recognize that we are imperfect people, and we pray that you heal the places inside of us that are broken, so that we might be your best hands and feet in the world, building a community of peace and love. And God, we confess to you that sometimes that takes the gift of strength, so that we can recognize those shortcomings we have and really step into the kind of person and Christian that we want to be. Today, we lift up with sadness and mourn the assault on laws across our country that protect minority voices and the experience of the most vulnerable. We pray for wisdom for our Supreme Court. We lift up the many young people who are wondering what's next for them with the assault on affirmative action. We pray that our church will always go the extra mile to include those who have been left out. We ask that you grant your wisdom in places where it is needed, so that laws that govern us do so with foresight, compassion, and the work of building your beloved community in mind. This morning, we lift up those in labor unrest across our land, the writers who are still striking, many of whom are in our congregation. This morning, we also add hotel workers to our prayers and their families, as they seek to build a better future for themselves here in Southern California and have gone on strike. Just be with us as we try to navigate this world and understand our place and how we can be helpful and do the things that you have called us to do. We know that you have each gifted every one of us with something that is valuable for the restoration of the world. There are many folks in our community in need of prayer, and we take a moment of silence now to lift them to you. Thank you, God, for receiving these prayers. We know that you bear all, that you carry so much for us. We add to these prayers for our brother Richard. In these days, may you grant him peace and courage. We pray for those who are giving him care. May you sustain them. And for all others who are experiencing illness and in need of healing. We lift this all to you, knowing that from you all gifts come and that you are the righteous, the gracious, and the most powerful one. We are grateful to you for your grace, for your love, and your compassion. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Happy first Sunday in July, church family. How are we all doing today? There we are. Good. I'm glad we're all doing good. Happy Independence Day coming up soon, or as I like to say here in LA, Independence Month, because you can hear fireworks at any time, 2 a.m., pretty much every night. All right, let us check in. Get your phones out, if you would, and scan that QR code. Just drop your name in there, email if you're new, and then any prayer requests that you have. I get those every week, so please add those too. Tomorrow is Monday movie night. We're going to see Indiana Jones at the Grove at 7. So if you're interested in doing that with me and a couple others, see me after church in the courtyard and we'll talk more about it. The next Sunday, this is actually a special treat. You can pick up one of these little invitations to remind yourself or to invite someone else. But we're having Rev Jefferson from the Harmony Toluca Lake campus come over. He's going to do a very relaxing, restorative meditation worship sound bath for us after church. That's going to happen in the chapel. So if you want, there'll be chairs set up if you just want to sit down. But if you want to bring a yoga mat, neck pillow, something comfortable to wear, people can lay out on the carpet as well, and it actually is amazing. I've done them before. Also, coming up this month, we have a VBS, our first VBS, on July 15th at 9:45 a.m. here on this campus in our backyard park and in the gym. It's for kids anywhere from 3 years to fifth grade, so family fun there. And then also, let's not forget, August 6th, I keep saying it, but I want to make sure everybody's here for our church picnic and kids' water day. It'll be a lot of fun, so it'll be a great barbecue and time for the kids to enjoy some water activities in the big slide. Oh, I don't have the picture. Big slide that we get every year. All right. Oh, also, if you want, pick up one of these. This tells you all of the family activities we have planned for this coming summer. These are all on the welcome table, either in the narthex or there's one in the courtyard as well. Real quick, just in case you've been noticing, I want to make sure I just rip this off the wall for you. We've been installing these around the church campus. You'll see one in the narthex. First of all, don't lift it up unless you want to hear a really loud noise. But these buttons are designed to help us with a silent alarm if there's any reason that we need to have that happen. So as you know, that every once in a while I'll talk about what to do in a case of emergency. This would be one of the things we're implementing this month just for extra security, and we just want everybody to feel safe here while at church. So that's what those are. If you see them around, we'll talk more about them. There'll be also training coming up for people who want to know more about it. Okay, Crossflix, as you know, starts today, but next week we are doing the film A Man Called Otto, and our very own Bishop Marianne Swenson will be giving the message on that. And then any of the, if you want to know all the titles, you can go to our website, just look up hollywoodumc.org/crossflix, that'll give you all the speakers and the dates for the films. But today, we are doing The Woman King with our special guest speaker, Dr. Larry Hygh Jr. Now, I wrote this for you, Larry, so enjoy it. You can usually find Larry at the Harmony Campus or one of LA's tastiest restaurants. An educator, a talented speaker, a social media guru, and a lover of anything cooked on a grill, please help me welcome today Dr. Larry Hygh Jr. Come over here for a second. We're also going to talk a little bit about annual conference that we did a couple weeks ago. And Larry was there, and so was Emily, and so was I. And so I'm giving the mic to you.
All right. Good morning, everyone. And I'm going to just talk briefly about annual conference. Annual conference is when we are a member of the California Pacific Annual Conference of the United Methodist Church, which simply means we are part of the regional body that includes the 400 United Methodist churches in Southern California, Hawaii, Guam, and Saipan. And so there are Rev. Kathy, Pastor Bridie, and Pastor Mark, as well as the three of us, and Jace, intern Jace over at Harmony Toluca Lake, were at annual conference session. And so to represent both our Hollywood and Harmony Toluca Lake campus, just a few highlights. We welcomed our new bishop this year, Bishop Dottie Escobedo Frank, and she will join us later this year as we continue to celebrate the AIDS ribbon, and she will you will meet her later this year. Our own Reverend Mary Ann Pickard was ordained an elder in the United Methodist Church, and I know she's already been serving. Pastor Mark, we have what's called General Conference and Jurisdictional Conference coming up in 2024, where the whole worldwide United Methodist Church gathers, and that's going to be in May, early May, in Charlotte, North Carolina, and Pastor Mark is one of our delegates to the General Conference from our region. Myself and Reverend Denise Barnes, who used to serve here, we've been elected as reserves, and so we'll go to Spokane in July as the western part of the United States gathers. Pastor Bridie challenged us during annual conference session on our commitment to labor and what we're going to do so that all God's children in Los Angeles get to participate in the bounty of the wealth that is created. So she challenged us around labor issues. I facilitated three sessions, one on anti-racism and one on our collective budget. You hear sometimes as apportionments, but it's our collective, the way we do ministry around the world as United Methodists. And so those are just a few things that took place. There was some dynamic worship, a whole bunch of great sermons, and just fellowship. And I encourage you to go to CalPacUMC, that's CalPacUMC.org. If you would like to see any of this, the recorded sermons are there, the sessions are there, so I encourage you to go there, but that's just a few of the things that took place from our Hollywood and Harmony Toluca Lake campuses as we gathered as a regional body.
See what I mean? I didn't have to say a word.
Very talented speaker.
We had a great time as well. Serving and representing the church at the conference. All that we do here is made possible by you, with your prayers and your presence and your service and your financial gifts. So as the ushers come forward and we put up a QR code for electronic giving, please give as generously as you're able so we can continue to do the ministry here in the heart of Hollywood. Thank you so much.
a reading from Judges chapter 4, verses 4 through 10. At that time, Deborah, a prophetess, wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel. She used to sit under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites came up to her for judgment. She sent and summoned Barak, son of Abinoam, in Kedesh from Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take position at Mount Tabor, bringing 10,000 from the tribe of Naphtali and the tribe of Zebulun. I will draw out Sisera, the general of Jabin's army, to meet you by the Wadi Kishon with his chariots and his troops, and I will give him into your hand." Barak said to her, "If you will go with me, I will go. But if you will not go with me, I will not go." And she said, "I will surely go with you. Nevertheless, the road on which you are going will not lead to your glory, for the Lord will sell Sisera into the hand of a woman." Then Deborah got up and went with Barak to Kedesh. Barak summoned Zebulun and Naphtali to Kedesh, and 10,000 warriors went up behind him, and Deborah went up with him. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Thanks be to God.
I was glad when they said unto me, "Let us go into the house of the Lord." This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall be glad and rejoice in it this morning. As we begin our Crossflix series, and we focus this morning on the woman king, the scripture Suzanne just lifted up so amazing for your hearing. And I'm going to focus this morning, my key verses are going to be verses 8 and 9 of what was just lifted up. Barak said to her, "If you will go with me, I will go. But if you will not go with me, I will not go." And she said, "I will surely go with you. Nevertheless, the road on which you are going will not lead to your glory, for the Lord will sell Sisera into the hand of a woman." Then Deborah got up and went with Barak to Kedesh. For just a few minutes this morning, I want us to focus around the subject, the thought, the reflection, into the hand of a woman. Into the hand of a woman. The Woman King is a film about the Agoji, the all-female warrior unit that protected the West African kingdom of Dahomey during the 17th to 19th centuries. Set in the 1820s, the film stars Viola Davis as a general who trains the next generations of warriors to fight their enemies. A group of all-female warriors protects the African kingdom with skills and fierceness unlike anything the world has ever seen. Faced with a new threat, General Aniska trains the next generation of recruits to fight against a foreign enemy that's determined to destroy their way of life. Let's take a look.
An evil is coming that threatens our kingdom, our freedom. But we have a weapon. They are not prepared for.
My king, the Europeans wish to conquer us. They will not stop until the whole of Africa is theirs. We must fight back for our people.
Aniska, you are asking me to take them to war. War.
Some things are worth fighting for.
Don't know.
You are called to join the king's guard. No kingdom in all of Africa shares this privilege. Train hard, fight harder. We fear no one. And we fear no pain. I offer you a choice. Fight or we die. To be a warrior, you must kill your tears.
We are the spear of victory! We are the blade of freedom! We are the homie!
Don't know.
In the West African kingdom of Dahomey in 1823, General Naniska, leader of the all-female group of warriors, the Agoji, liberates Dahomeyan women who were abducted by slavers from the Oyo Empire. This provokes King Gezo of Dahomey to prepare for an all-out war with the Oyo. General Naniska begins to train a new generation of warriors to join the Agoji to protect the kingdom. Among these warriors is Nawi, a strong-willed girl who was offered by her father to the king after refusing to marry men who would beat her. Nawi befriends Izogi, a veteran Agoji. She also reveals to Naniska that she is adopted and shows a scar on her left shoulder, shocking Naniska. In the end, General Naniska leads the Agoji in an attack on the Oyo. The attack is successful, but Oba, one of the warriors, escapes, and three of the other warriors are captured. With Nawi's advice, she escapes and reports the other's fate to General Naniska. King Gezo prepares to bestow the title of Woman King, his partner and equal in ruling Dahomey, upon General Naniska, but refuses to authorize the rescue mission for the captive Agoji. General Naniska defies orders and sets out with a group of like-minded warriors to rescue the captives. The triumphant Agoji return to Dahomey, where King Gezo privately and briefly admonishes General Naniska for disobeying him before crowning her the Woman King. After the festivities, General Naniska and Nawi privately acknowledge their familial relationship. While most of the Woman King and its characters were largely fictionalized, a few of its central roles were inspired by actual accounts of Agoji women. The adolescent character Nawi was known as one of the last of the Agoji warriors who passed away in 1979 at the age of over 100 years. In the passage of scripture that was lifted up a few minutes ago, we meet an unlikely leader, a woman in the form of a judge, a prophetess by the name of Deborah. Deborah helps to lead some folks into battle, and I encourage you in your quiet time this week to read the entire story of Deborah and Judges, but I'm going to give you a brief recap. We meet the Israelites in the beginning of this chapter, and they again have done evil before the Lord. The Lord then turned them over to Jabin, king of Canaan, who ruled in Hazor. The general of Jabin's army was Sisera. The Israelites began to cry out to the Lord for help. They cried out because Sisera oppressed and kept them down for 20 years. Sisera had 900 chariots with iron-reeled rims, and these 900 chariots helped him to dominate the Israelites, which made for a very bad situation. In walks a shade tree prophetess, a judge by the name of Deborah. Deborah worked in a satellite office or from a remote location. She telecommuted before it was the norm. Deborah did not work in Jerusalem, but beneath the shade of a date palm tree, nearly 10 miles to the north in the mountains of Ephraim between Ramah and Bethel. And as we know, living here in Southern California, date palm trees are huge. When folks had a problem, when they had a beef, they came out to Deborah at the palm tree and she settled their disputes and she judged them. Word got out that God's will could be known through Deborah, and many came to her for judgment. During these bad times for Israel, while they were being oppressed by Sisera, Deborah, the prophetess, calls for Barak and issues him this decree. Is it not true that the Lord God of Israel is commanding you? Go, march to Mount Tabor. Take with you 10,000 men from Naphtali and Zebulun. I will bring Sisera, the general of Jabin's army, to you at the Kishon River, along with his chariots and his huge army. Barak hears this word from the Lord through Deborah, but it is not enough for him. He refuses to obey unless Deborah goes with him. Barak is then rebuked by Deborah because of his lack of faith. She assures Barak that she will accompany him, but he will not get the glory for the victory over the Canaanites that God has promised. They go in, there is victory. The Israelites overcame the Canaanites. The victory belonged to the Lord. He routed Sisera and all his chariots. There are three things this morning that I want us to explore and learn as we think about the woman king and General Naniska and the prophetess Deborah. The first thing is that God uses unlikely people in leadership. God uses unlikely people in leadership. Second, God is with you when the odds are stacked against you. God is with you when the odds are stacked against you. And finally, God has used powerful women all throughout history for God's glory. God has used powerful women all throughout history for God's glory. God uses unlikely people in leadership. It was not a common occurrence to see a woman in leadership during this period. We see a woman who is leading Israel at the time. Deborah has a commanding style of leadership. Deborah was articulate and she pressed for immediate action. She had victory in mind and she set out to put in place the necessary folks who could carry out the job. Deborah was a leader. She was a leader because she did not sit back and wait for Barak to come to her. She led by sending for him. She was willing to do what was necessary to get the job done, even if it meant going into battle, just like General Naniska in The Woman King. Deborah was not concerned about whether others approved or disapproved of her behavior. She was not concerned that other women had not previously served as judges. She did not consult a committee. She did not consult a group to decide a course of action. Deborah saw the problem. She indicated the necessary course of action, and then she actively participated to ensure the outcome. There are some of you right now. There are some of you that God has given a vision, and you are scared of what the naysayers might say. You're telling yourself, I'm too young to be a leader. I'm too old to be a leader. I'm too young or too old to change things in the community. I'm a minority, I'm a woman, I'm gay. You fill in your own blank in your set of excuses. I challenge you this morning to quit making excuses and step up to the plate and lead. Deborah could have said, I'm a woman and women have never led folks into battle. But Deborah didn't. She stepped up to the plate when her people needed her. We've got to step up as the people of faith call United Methodists. We've got to lead in ways that lead to a prosperous society for all of God's children. Don't be concerned this morning with all of the haters out there. With God on your side, you can lead. Don't let folks label you and place you in a box. I'm going to say that again. Don't let folks label you and place you in a box. God uses ordinary people, regular folks, to do extraordinary things. Be true to who you are. God uses unlikely people like General Naniska and the prophetess Deborah in leadership. Not only does God use them in leadership, but God is with us when the odds are stacked against us. God is with us this morning when the odds are stacked against us. The odds were stacked against Deborah and Barak, but you see, Deborah led because she knew that God was with her in the moment of crisis. The battle must have been some sight to see. Barak went into the battle with his men armed with little or nothing. Sisera had his well-armed soldiers and 900 iron-rimmed chariots. Barak went into war after 20 years of being oppressed. Sisera went into war after 20 years of being a mean, oppressive ruler. Sisera was probably accompanied by military strategists, while Barak is accompanied by Deborah, who is a wife and a mother in Israel. Deborah and Barak went in with a God-given war plan that made little sense from a military perspective. Chariots were effective vehicles on the plains, the flatlands, but they were of little use in the mountains. In verse 14, during the battle, Deborah proclaims, "Up, for this day in which the Lord has delivered Sisera into your hand, has not the Lord gone out before you?" My brothers and sisters, the Lord has gone out before you. God is with you when the odds have been stacked against you. I can believe that God is with us because in the Old Testament, I met a man by the name of Joseph. And God protected Joseph and delivered him out of the pit of bondage and slavery and out of prison. When Joseph's brothers approach him at the end of the story, after they decided not to kill them, they just sold their brother into slavery. They decided not to kill them. And then he tells them, "You meant it for my bad, but God used it to bless me and you." I can believe that God is with us because I've read in Exodus about two Hebrew midwives that feared God, whose names were Shiphrah and Puah, and after defying Pharaoh's orders, not only did God protect them, but God blessed them. I can believe that God is with us because I've also read in Exodus about the Israelites as they approached the Red Sea, and in their defense, God parted the waters. I can believe that God is with us this morning because I've met Joshua as he fought the Battle of Jericho. I've met Daniel in the lion's den who made the lion's pillows for his head to lay. I've met David who slew a giant named Goliath. I've met three Hebrew boys by the name of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego who refused to bow down to a golden image that King Nebuchadnezzar set up. And not only did God protect them, but God showed up in the midst of the fire with them. You might be telling yourself right now, "Well, Larry, all those folks are in the Old Testament. That was a long time ago. What has God done lately?" Well, I challenge you that God is with us in all of life's interactions. All you have to do is look back on the track record that we call life. As you look back over the track record called your life, you will realize that God has a plan and a purpose for your life. The Bible asks the question, "If God be for you, who can be against you?" When the odds are stacked against you and people say you can't, I know a God this morning that says you can. God is with us this morning when the odds are stacked against us. God uses unlikely people in leadership. God is with us when the odds are stacked against us. And I want us to realize that God has used powerful women all throughout history for God's glory. We meet Sarah, Abraham's wife. Her offspring became the nation of Israel, which produced Jesus Christ, Savior of the world. At 90, Sarah gave birth to Isaac through a miracle from God. From Sarah, we learn that God's promises always come true, and God's timing is always the best timing. Into the hands this morning of a woman. We meet Jochebed, the mother of Moses. She influenced history by surrendering what she treasured most of all to the will of God. When the Egyptians began killing the male babies of Hebrew slaves, Jochebed put Moses in a waterproof basket and set it adrift on the Nile River. Pharaoh's daughters found and adopted him as her own son. God arranged it so that Jochebed could be the baby's wet nurse. Even though Moses was raised as an Egyptian, God chose him to lead his people to freedom. The faith of Jochebed saved Moses to become Israel's great prophet and lawgiver into the hands of a woman. We meet Rahab, a prostitute in the city of Jericho. When the Hebrews began to conquer Canaan, Rahab harbored their spies in her house in exchange for her family's safety. Rahab recognized the true God, and after the walls of Jericho fell, the Israelite army kept their promise, protecting Rahab's house. Rahab became the ancestors of King David, and from David's line came Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Into the hands this morning of a woman, we meet Mary, the mother of Jesus, who is a touching example in the Bible of total surrender to the will of God. Despite an angel told her she would become the mother of the Savior through the Holy Spirit, despite the potential shame, she submitted and she gave birth to Jesus. She married Joseph, serving as parents to the Son of God. During her life, Mary bore much sorrow, including watching her son crucified on Calvary, but she also saw him raised from the dead. Mary is revered as a loving influence on Jesus, a devoted servant who honored God by saying yes. Into the hands this morning of a woman, we meet the women at the tomb who realize that the stone has been rolled away. It's the women who are instructed to go and tell that the Lord is risen from the dead, while the men were off hiding. It's the women who were entrusted with the resurrection message. God has used powerful women all throughout history for God's glory. God used Black Moses, Harriet Tubman, to lead her people to freedom from slavery. God used Sojourner Truth and Ida B. Wells as advocates for abolition, temperance, and civil and women's rights. God used a woman from the Mississippi Delta declaring that she was sick and tired of being sick and tired to advance voting and women's rights. Fannie Lou Hamer was a community organizer and a leader in the civil rights movement. The men of the civil rights movement that we celebrate would not have been the men they were without the women who supported and undergirded their work. We would not have Martin without Coretta. We would not have Malcolm without Betty. And we would not have Megger without Merle. And we would never have heard about Martin's dreams on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial if his friend, gospel singer Mahalia Jackson, hadn't shouted to him, "Martin, tell them about your dream." God used a woman by the name of Dr. Dorothy Hygh to develop a strategy for the civil rights movement and lead the National Council of Negro Women. God used Rosa Parks to sit down on a bus to galvanize a moment that led to full integration. God used a woman to come into the U.S. House of Representatives to come and declare that she was unbought and unbossed. She then had the audacity to run for the President of the United States of America. Shirley Chisholm led the way and paved the ground for the election of our first Black and woman Vice President, Kamala Harris. It's into the hands of the women. And I think it's the women who are going to help us fix our current situation in which we find ourselves in this country. We don't have to look far. We don't have to look far in our orbit to find powerful women who God continues to use for God's glory. We are led by our own Reverend Kathy Cooper Ledesma, who continues to push for inclusion, for a seat at the table for all of God's children. She pushes us towards our church's vision to inspire the world as passionate followers of Jesus Christ so all may experience God's life-giving love. We see our own Pastor Bridie Roberts. She's on the front lines fighting for the rights of workers, and she sometimes gets arrested, but she wants to help us to make sure that the arc of the moral universe bends towards justice. She fights the good fight so that all Angelenos might share in the bounty of wealth that is generated. We see our own Bishop Mary Ann Swenson, who some have called the Methodist Pope. And she teaches us what it means to live in harmony and work with our neighbors of different faiths. She was working towards inclusion and diversity before diversity, equity, and inclusion was even popular and trending. To God this morning be the glory for these amazing women. God has used powerful women all throughout history for God's glory. Right now, I want you to think of the women who have had an impact in your life. These women might still be among us, or they might be among the ancestors. And I encourage you right now to speak their names out loud, to speak their names out loud. And for those of you online, I encourage you to type it in the chat, but speak their names out loud and type it in the chat. This morning, it's into the hands of the women. God uses unlikely people in leadership. God is with us when the odds are stacked against us. And God has used powerful women all throughout history for God's glory. Barak said to her, "If you will go with me, I will go. But if you will not go with me, I will not go." And she said, "I will surely go with you. Nevertheless, the road on which you are going will not lead to your glory, for the Lord will sell Sisera into the hand of a woman." Then Deborah got up and went with Barak to Kadesh. God uses unlikely people in leadership. God is with us when the odds are stacked against us. And God has used powerful women all throughout history for God's glory. My brothers and sisters, this morning, it's into the hands of the women. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. In the name of God the Father, in the name of God the Son, and in the name of God's Holy Spirit, let the people of God this morning say hallelujah and amen.
Brother Larry, that was some preaching today. Thanks be to God. Woo. Didn't he give us a Bible lesson? He took us through the whole Bible today. I was so moved. That was so fun. And we're blessed now to be able to get ready to come to the table, because even though our Bible story says it was Jesus and those 12 men sitting around that table, we knew the women had prepared the meal. And there were some powerful women that God used to prepare that meal when all of them could gather around the table. They gathered around the table, and when they did, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to God. He broke the bread. And he said to his friends, "Women and men, this is my body that is given for you. Every time you break bread together, I am there with you. I have called you by name. You are mine." And after the supper, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks to God, as was the tradition in his faith. And then he said to his friends who were gathered at the table, "This is the blood of the new covenant that is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you shall drink it, do so in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts of Jesus, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. And so we pray, O God, will you pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us who are gathered here at the table and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be the body of Christ for the world and share Christ's love in this broken world. Make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes again and we celebrate at the heavenly banquet. And so now, my brothers and sisters, with confidence as the children of God, let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The table of the Lord is open to everyone. You do not need to be a member of this church or of any church. You simply have to come and be present. The cup is grape juice. There's a gluten-free option that the ushers will move to the center. And all a gluten-free wafer. And also, if you do not want to dip your bread in the cup, you can receive a little tiny cup. So the table is set, and we are all invited. following the post-soon, I hope you will join us in the courtyard for cookies, Girl Scout cookies this month, and a fellowship, simply to get to know someone that you don't know. And once again, can we thank Dr. Larry Hart Jr., who is our governance board chair for both campuses. Go now, go knowing that God loves you, that God has called you, no matter what your circumstances, to be in leadership, and know that God will always be with you in the struggles. We pray this now and send you off. Amen.